Welcome to Planet Lex, the podcast of Northwestern Pritzker School of Law, with your host, Dean Daniel B. Rodriguez, bringing it to you from Chicago, Illinois. Take it away, Dan.
Hello, and welcome to Northwestern Law's Planet Lex, podcasting from the Northwestern Pritzker School of Law in Chicago. I'm your host, Dean Dan Rodriguez. My guest today is Northwestern Law visiting distinguished scholar Zach Fardon. Zach was the United States Attorney for the Northern District of Illinois from 2013 until early 2017. Under his leadership, the U.S. Attorney's Office was recognized for numerous significant investigations and prosecutions involving international terrorism and terrorism financing, public corruption, corporate fraud, violent crime, narcotics, and gangs. As U.S. Attorney, Zach directed the implementation of Project Safe Neighborhoods, a federal anti-gun violence initiative with the Chicago Police Department, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, and the Cook County State's Attorney's Office. Now he is managing partner and head of litigation for the Chicago office of King & Spalding. And I've been delighted to have him, welcomed here as a visiting distinguished scholar at the law school during this year. Zach led an incredible series of discussions over the course of the year featuring different perspectives on Chicago's gun violence problem. He opened the series with a lecture on what he learned about the issue as U.S. attorney, then held five panels featuring law enforcement, nonprofit and community leaders, local government officials, business and philanthropy leaders, and finally, amazingly, high school students from some of the neighborhoods most plagued by gun violence. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you,
today, Zach. So I want to start with your experience with gun violence as a United States attorney. You penned this remarkable document, this open letter, in early 2017 after, not to bring up bad memories, but after the so-called Obama administration holdovers in the U.S. Attorney's Office were abruptly asked to resign by President Trump. Another topic for another day. But you drafted this incredible open letter calling for reform in the Chicago law enforcement community's efforts to combat gun violence. To the listeners, I strongly commend the letter, all six pages of it. But for the purpose of this podcast, can you summarize the content of that letter and explain your decision to write something so public?
Sure. I mean, the nub of the content, Dean, was it was my honest and earnest recitation of how I came to see the gun violence epidemic in Chicago based on my learnings and experiences as U.S. attorney for those 3.5 years, including the distinction between the short-term trends in gun violence and the long-term realities of the epidemic. And then I offered a list, not exhaustive, not magical, but a top five list indicating some things that I thought and think can and should be done to help address the gun violence issue.
I want to get to some of the specifics, but just looking at the issue from 10,000 feet, many things struck me about this letter, but you began on the one hand with some truly bad news. And by bad news, I don't mean just describing the statistics, which are horrific, of gun violence and unabated, right? You talk about the present, but you also talk about the past in 2012, 13, 14, really over the entirety of your time here. But you also humanize it. These are real people. Early on in the letter, you talk about the killing of Hadiya Pendleton, happened not long after you taking office. And then 2014, Laquan McDonald and many others you could have named. So these are, of course, are human issues. But the letter presupposes a great amount of optimism. Just the time and energy and trouble that you would take to suggest these solutions suggests that there really is to be optimistic. And again, we want to get into some of the actual suggestions, but what gives you that optimism that we could really turn this corner?
There are a number of things. First and foremost, the just critical mass of goodwill and philanthropy and like-minded people who care deeply about this issue and are committed to trying to bring us to a better place. I was not plugged in a way that I am now. Before I was the U.S. attorney, I had this great honor. I spent hundreds of hours focused on the gun violence epidemic, and I had this great honor to meet so many different people from so many different walks of life who care deeply about this issue and who, for the most part, are like-minded in terms of the causes of the long-term epidemic and the things that need to happen to solve it. And then on the philanthropy side, I came to learn that there's so much money already being invested toward addressing these issues, and that much more that I think could be invested if there were greater kind of efficiencies and focus and a sort of optimism about how that money would be spent and long-term solutions. So look, I'm an adoptive child of Chicago. Mm-hmm. I grew up in the Southeast in Knoxville, Tennessee. I had never set foot in the city of Chicago until 1997 when I came up here to serve as an assistant U.S. attorney. It wasn't even a dream of mine that I could ever get to serve in the various capacities I have, including as the United States attorney here. And I find myself, you know, here 20 years later, now in love with the city of Chicago, deeply respectful of the people of Chicago, and optimism built on the back of my belief that we have passionate, earnest, altruistic people in this town who want to bring us to a better place. And when you have that and you start to focus on and be honest about the root causes and the underlying problem, then I think there's a pathway to success over time.
So let's turn back to some of those root causes. You talk about the basic paradigm that exists, particularly in specific neighborhoods in Chicago. Can you talk a bit about that? What is it that is happening in Chicago that gives rise to this incredible epidemic of gun violence?
Well, you mentioned the panel series that we've had here over the last 5 months, and I want to thank you and the law school for allowing me to host that series, because I do think there have been some pretty amazing moments during the course of that in terms of just honest and impactful discourse, and maybe particularly about those root causes. Mm-hmm. I think you mentioned the kids, and I think especially if you were to sit down for an hour and 15 minutes and watch that video, then what I'm about to say would have much greater resonance than it will coming out of my mouth. But the bottom line is this: as I said in the letter, for decades, the neighborhoods that are disproportionately impacted by gang and gun violence, which is a small percentage point of Chicago's overall geography and populace, less than 10%, those neighborhoods on the south.
And for those who may be listening who are not Chicagoans, typically the south and the west sides of the city?
Correct. Yes. And it's a small piece of the footprint. And those neighborhoods, for decades, have been neglected. The poverty rates in those neighborhoods generally runs 2+ times the average poverty rate of other neighborhoods in the city of Chicago. Those neighborhoods, if you drive through them, you will notice that they do not have the typical supermarkets and grocery stores and Targets and other commercial businesses that you might come to expect. The infrastructure is not as strong. The roads are not as good. The public transportation is not as good. The schools struggle. There aren't as many businesses there. There aren't as many opportunities there. And so they stand rot with poverty and suffer across the board in those categories. And meanwhile, we have kids growing up in those neighborhoods, often in single parent homes. You heard from that youth panel a few weeks ago, the reality that often in those households, there's no father or father figure present. And so kids, there is at an early age, a sense of hopelessness. I think young kids growing up in those neighborhoods often don't believe that they're worthy of higher education. They don't think they're smart enough, which is not true. And they don't see a pathway toward opportunity in terms of a decent job or wage.
How about the schools, just to bring it back to the beginning, before we even get to higher education, The predicament of the Chicago public schools? We're bouncing around a lot of big topics,
sure,
but just focusing on those neighborhoods. Do they find opportunity in their attendance at school in those neighborhoods?
Some do, and I don't mean to undersell it. And Jadine Chow, who's the head of security for CPS, was part of this panel discussion. And some of the schools do great work in those neighborhoods, and there are lives literally that get saved by good teachers and principals in those neighborhoods. But it would be remiss not to observe that the graduation rate in those schools is lower than it is in other neighborhoods, and the college attendance, the secondary attendance education rate, is much lower than it is in other neighborhoods. There really isn't the expectation that you have in a lot of Chicago neighborhoods that kids are going to go to high school, do well, graduate from high school, go to college, and beyond. That's the expectation I grew up with, not in Chicago, but sure, I think most Chicago kids in most neighborhoods, that's the expectation they grew up with. That's upside down in these neighborhoods. That's not the expectation. That does happen for certain kids and their heroic teachers and
Absolutely.
Educators out there who make it happen. But it's not the expectation, and obviously it needs to be. We need to create an ostensible pathway to self-identity and success for these young folks, because right now they don't see it. And what fills that void, as I said in the letter, gangs. Gangs are everywhere. And the gangs adopt these children at a very tender age. And I did not fully appreciate this until I was a U.S. attorney. But we're talking first, second, third grades that kids are starting to gang.
And what are they doing? They're on if those of us who learn about this from watching The Wire and other programs, are they the ones who are out on the stoops of homes?
Yeah.
Lookouts.
Look, at that age, it's mostly social, right? It's when I say first, second, third grade, it's not like gang members are handing first graders guns and saying, go out and sell dope. That's not how it works. It is a social affiliation. It's a network of people who distinguish themselves through their gang affiliation and by having other gangs that are rival gangs that you do not cross those lines and you do not socialize
with. And the folks who are up the network food chain, as it were, are the heroes to these young kids.
Yeah, that's absolutely
a substitute for their fathers or others.
That to the extent that they see success in front of them in those neighborhoods, that's what success often looks like. And that is part of the problem. And so by becoming affiliated with those gangs at an early age, over time, those kids find themselves in a position, A, of carrying guns, and B, of making often just impulsive decisions that result in people dying and people going to prison. And that's a fundamental part of this paradigm that regardless of the ebbs and flows, that's true today, right? We're having 25 plus percent down from shootings and homicides from this time last year. And that's great. And we're all very happy about that trend. But that paradigm is as true right now as it was a year ago or 2 years ago or 5 years ago or 20 years ago. And that's part of what we need to back up and address.
I want to come back into the neighborhoods, as it were. Before I do that, let me take a step out of the neighborhoods. And I was struck by a news item. So I live in the Gold Coast. I live in a fairly affluent part of the city, not far from where we are now in the law school. And there was a recent carjacking, really less than a week ago. And fortunately, no one was killed, but there were a couple folks shot. And then quotations from folks in the neighborhood immediately in the aftermath was essentially, well, this doesn't happen here. This is not our city. This happens elsewhere in those particular neighborhoods. And it really reinforced precisely this point, is there's a strong and profound sense, maybe distinctly about Chicago, where it's a violence in these other neighborhoods that does not impact and touch and get onto the attention span of so many of the more affluent or even relatively upper middle class folks in the community. It sounds like that's a correct characterization. How do we get out of that mindset?
It is a correct characterization, although the gun violence very much impacts them, because to the extent you have national listeners, those national listeners know sure. that when people think of and talk about Chicago, outside of the city of Chicago.
You and I experience it all the time. I get in a cab in Tokyo, Japan, or in Amsterdam, or certainly in other parts of the country. They're like, Chicago, everybody's killing each
right.
other all the time.
Gun violence, and so that becomes definitional to the city, which hurts our economy and hurts us in all sorts of ways. And so, yeah, I mean, I think what has to be done about that is we have to find ways to cause people, to motivate people who are not living in, growing up in those neighborhoods and where otherwise not sort of immediately impacted, don't have those issues directly in front of them, to get them involved, to get them invested. You started by asking me about my optimism. I believe that we have the tools to get there. And one of the things that makes me optimistic is we're not talking about 50% of Chicago. You can say two Chicagos, you can say Chirac. This ain't 50-50. We're talking about 7 or 8% somewhere in that neighborhood of the geographic footprint and the overall populace. And so we can focus on that limited geographic footprint, and we can take all of these folks who, like you and me, have been so fortunate in so many different ways, and whether it's money or the ability to serve as a mentor or working in after-school programs, or you have celebrities, you have athletes, you have different people who can pay it forward in different ways. If we find a more focused way to bring all of that to bear in those neighborhoods, just within the four corners of the city of Chicago, just the people who are here, I know that we can shift that paradigm over years, but we need leadership, and the people have to want it.
We've mentioned a couple times the remarkable last panel of the series that involved talking to the kids. And one of the things that I was struck with being there is of just listening and engagement with these young people without the access to these role models. I mean, it's be Pollyannish to say that that's the solution. It's far from the solution. But the engagement where they are in the neighborhoods and engaging them in a way certainly seemed to reinforce precisely that optimism.
I completely agree. And look, here's what I would say to your listeners, and thank you for the plug about the panels. Mm-hmm. And you can go online and watch,
absolutely
watch those
all of them.
Videos. And I would ask you also, you know, jump 10 minutes in, get through the introductory stuff, and forgive my stammering as I ask those kids questions, because the substance of what came out of the mouths of those young leaders in those neighborhoods is striking, is remarkable, not only for its honesty and its earnestness, but they do not unduly view themselves as victims. These are just good kids who face tragic circumstances.
Even though every single one of them had been touched in some way.
Correct.
By gun violence.
Well, look, these are kids, so this is all definitionally beyond their control. They don't decide where they're born. They don't decide where they're waking up in the morning and walking outside, and for the most part, where they're going to school, and whether or not there's a grocery store or a bookstore somewhere in the neighborhood as opposed to just a liquor store and a gas station. And yet these kids have, I think, the savvy and the intellect to sort of understand fundamentally that they're in that predicament, know that it's not right, know that it's unfair, speak very honestly about what happens to their peers. These kids were sitting here at Northwestern Law School because they've made good choices over time. Many of their peers have not, and these kids know kids who've been shot, and they know kids who carry and who shoot. And you heard some of the statistics from their mouths about the percentage of young kids that carry weapons, firearms in these neighborhoods. And so you're talking about optimism. I mean, you focus on those young folks recognizing that they're living and growing up in these are 14, 15, 16, 18-year-old kids growing up in these neighborhoods. And I think there's no way not to, number one, feel passion and commitment to trying to change that paradigm to where they see the same advantages and realities that you and I see here and did growing up. Mm-hmm. And number two, empower them to help lead the way forward for their friends, their peers, their neighborhoods, because unfortunately, there are too many kids that don't find that pathway to good choices and only fall prey to the bad choices that they wake up and walk out the door to.
It may be irreversible. Let me dig in a bit, if I may, to some of the root causes and some of the elements of this. Law enforcement and the difficulties. We mentioned the McDonald shooting, and of course, that's been a predicament not unique to Chicago, but that's certainly plagued this city as so many other cities. The gun violence inflicted on citizens by law enforcement is obviously a complex phenomenon. To what extent does that, I mean, I'm not sure exactly how to come at the question, the distrust of law enforcement in this community, the inadequate training of police officers, all of that, how does that play into it?
Well, look, Dean, I said I put a list in that letter, top five things. The number one thing was get that consent decree. Mm-hmm. And I say that as somebody who has spent more than half of my 25-year career in law enforcement, sure, working with police officers. I love and respect police officers. If I could still be working with them now, I would be. Right. And yet, I will tell you, I was part of the Department of Justice Pattern and Practice investigation. I was part of asking for and initiating that investigation. And it is because, as I said in the letter, you can't do a good police department on the cheap, and you have to have, police officers have to have the trust and respect of the communities they serve. Otherwise, people in those neighborhoods will not cooperate with police officers when they're conducting investigations, which is one of the reasons we have one of the worst homicide solve rates in this city of any city in the country. And so the fundamental problem, and it's laid out in tremendous detail in the DOJ pattern and practice investigation findings, which I helped pen and I stand by, the fundamental problem is not that police officers in Chicago are bad or poorly trained or, you know, malicious. Most officers are good. The lion's share of officers are good and doing good work. Problem is you have a number of bad officers, as you always, you have 13,000 police officers. Here's a newsflash. You're going to have some bad apples in there. Right. There are no exceptions to that rule.
Absolutely.
So when those bad officers do bad things, there needs to be accountability. They need to be held accountable and accountable on a reasonably quick basis. Otherwise, the public loses faith and confidence.
Including civil damages, including criminal prosecution, including... So there's, as
there are lots
know,
of different
these,
vehicles.
There's
for,
immunity issues. There's all sorts of.
There are lots of different vehicles for accountability. And I know with the Laquan McDonald case, for example, people were and are frustrated by the time that the justice system has taken to address it from a criminal justice perspective. And I, you know, that has to be balanced with wanting to make sure that the presumption of innocence is honored and that due process for charged defendants is honored. And also efficacy of investigations and making sure that, you know, prosecutors get things right. So there's a balance there. But whatever the vehicle for accountability, whether it's internal to the police department, whether it's through the civil liability system, whether it's through the criminal justice system, people have to see that when bad cops do bad things, they're held accountable. And nobody needs that more than the good cops. Because the good cops are out there every day trying to do their jobs, trying to solve crimes, trying to engage in community policing and develop relationships and keep those neighborhoods safe. And yet that taint of the bad cop wears off on the good cop if there's no accountability that's manifest to the public at large.
Absolutely. Let me talk about another element of law enforcement, one, of course, that's been at the core of your career, which is prosecution. So you mentioned about these poor choices and individuals making perhaps irreversible choices. And these are individuals who are often prosecuted. They're prosecuted maybe through the juvenile system. They're prosecuted after their juveniles. The mass incarceration problem. So I'm going to ask this sort of in an overly provocative way. Aren't the district attorneys and the U.S. attorneys part of the source of the problem? They're aggressively prosecuting these individuals and they're going away for years.
No, I don't think that they're part of the source of the problem. Number one, I do think mass incarceration is a problem and is something that needed to be addressed. And I was part of the Obama administration at the time that the Smart on Crime was implemented. I was on Eric Holder's Attorney General Advisory Committee, what we call the AGAC, and was part of those discussions and think that the Smart on Crime policy, which was designed to ratchet down the number of really onerously long, draconian sort of prison sentences.
The so-called, I mean, was, in California, the three strikes and
some of these other. The mandatory minimums.
Exact mandatory minimums.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think that that policy, which has now been unwound, was a sound policy to address what I think had been an undue reliance on incarceration as a vehicle for addressing underlying issues related to violence. You know, having said that, and I said this, I think, at the first talk I gave as part of this panel series, and I'll say it again now, everything hard in life is about balance, and law enforcement and prosecutions is also about balance. There are bad people who are intent to do bad things, and when they get caught, they need to be prosecuted. In some cases, they need to be sent away to prison. In some cases, that needs to be for a long time, period, hard stop. I believe that as much now as I did my day one as a prosecutor in 1997. And yet, back to smart on crime, I have no doubt that over the course of decades, and particularly in our urgency to address the narcotics epidemic, the flow of first crack cocaine and powder cocaine and heroin into our communities, that those mandatory minimums began to result in sentences that were longer than necessary to both serve as punishment and deterrence and to protect our communities. And so that balance got askew. I don't put that on the prosecutors, although I do think every prosecutor, myself included, needs to struggle every day. And I came to work every day, and I think many of my colleagues here did as well, recognizing we're people, we're imperfect, it's an imperfect system. We have to constantly be asking ourselves, what are we doing? Why are we doing it? What sentence are we asking for? Why are we asking for that sentence? But I don't pick a point blame at the prosecutors for that phenomenon. I think we as a nation have to address and react to the data and the statistics and the paradigm as it evolves. And I think that that is part of what was happening during Eric Holder's tenure in the Obama administration. And I'm disappointed with the
swing of the pendulum back.
And again, I understand the rationale that's been articulated by this administration for wanting those more draconian sentences and seeking the mandatory minimums. But I fundamentally disagree with it. And I think it's going to set us back in terms of, you know, the long-term struggle to address the real core issues here.
Well, focusing on the current administration, there's been much attention. There was during the campaign when Donald Trump was running for president, and since he was elected, that Chicago's terrible and awful, and it's gang violence, and we're just going to sort of bring in the troops, as it were. I'm oversimplifying, but that the problem is really associated with these truly awful gangs. Is there a role to play? And if so, what is the role to play from federal law enforcement sort of swooping in to really deal with the worst of the worst of the gang?
You know, the number two thing I said in that letter, give us more federal resources. Mm-hmm. We need 15 to 20 more assistant United States attorneys, federal prosecutors who can investigate and prosecute gang and gun violence related cases. I do think that, you know, I, for one, was glad, and I say this in all earnestness, I was glad at the time that the president was paying attention to Chicago and calling out the violence epidemic in Chicago, because I would wake up every day wanting more help, more resources, more attention to these. Bring the spotlight to that. And yet, where are the additional resources? Where are the additional prosecutors? Where are the additional agents? And there have been some in patches here and there, but no more than in prior administrations. Right. And I think the federal government has a great responsibility. We've left the topic of the consent decree, but I had strong feelings on that issue as well. This is, to me, a national crisis. This is a social justice issue that has constitutional implications and has national self-identity implications. We have 5, 6, 7-year-old kids who can't walk 2 blocks to school without getting hit by an errant bullet. And that is unacceptable in the United States of America. And I doubt the president or anyone else is going to disagree with that. The answer, as I said in the letter, isn't send in the National Guards and just basically shut down those neighborhoods and create war zones. That sends exactly the wrong message, as I said in the letter. If you're just focused on the statistics over coming months, yes, that will have a positive impact. But it's over time going to make those neighborhoods worse and not better because of the message it sends to the people who are growing up and trying to raise their families in those neighborhoods. We need more federal resources. We need more local resources. We need more business and philanthropy and not-for-profit. And all of those sectors have many great people doing important work. But that's sort of the point of drawing a circle around this epidemic and asking people
to
really own it, understanding that it's complex, understanding that, I said this as a U.S. attorney, I've said it over and over again as part of this panel series, this is a generational issue. This is not something that, you know, this year, despite the fact that we're having a good year, and I'm very, very grateful for that, we're not going to be declaring victory this year or next year or 2 years from now or 5 years from now.
Because statistics are still bad. They may be less bad
than they were. My first 2 years, Dean, and you probably know this as U.S. attorney, but 2014, 2015, we saw the lowest homicide rate since 1965 and 1967 in the city of Chicago, respectively. And so those were relatively quiet years as well. And I was, believe me, as a U.S. attorney, very grateful for that. But it didn't change that the 1-2 punch that I articulated at the beginning of this conversation, small number of neighborhoods that are not okay. Not okay now, weren't okay before. And we kids, disproportionately in this town versus others, I think kids who are both trigger pullers and who are getting killed by errant bullets and otherwise. And those two things are just not American. We can't accept that as a society. And so I do think it is first and foremost a Chicago issue. Those of us who live here and love this place need to step up and help address this issue. But yes, I believe it's a federal issue, and I don't think that there have been sufficient federal resources and attention brought to bear.
When I was listening to you, I was also refreshing my recollection of your letter, and I wanted to make sure I was right in my recollection. There's not a lot in the letter about the availability of guns and the phenomenon of gun control, which is very much in the news. These mass shootings and school shootings and all of that. We, Chicago suffers like other communities suffer. But, you know, my observation is, while those are horrible suffering, we get an attention drawn quite rightly to issues about availability of guns and AK-47s and shootings at schools. That's not really what you and I are talking about here, right? The epidemic of gun violence in the community. But I do want to ask, are part of the solutions just getting these guns off the street?
So the CPD takes 6,000-7,000 guns off the street every single year and has for a long time, more than most other major police departments. So there are a lot of guns coming off the street. Our city has porous borders. It is easy to drive.
Indiana, the gun traffic from Indiana,
which has much looser gun regulations. You can go to a gun show in Indiana and with a driver's license, buy a bag of guns and drive across the border. And there's nothing law enforcement can do about that. And so that's one of the reasons I didn't address it. And I do think there are too many guns. I do think there needs to be better gun regulation. I think there are ways that we can leverage technology, particularly, to try to improve that over time. Having said that, I suppose I also accept the premise that we're going to have guns in society, and if bad guys want to find guns, bad guys are going to find guns. And so
we also have the Second Amendment. We have protections, of gun ownership that, if I may, the argument is folks who live in the West and in the South sides shouldn't be disabled of their constitutional
100%
rights.
100% agreed.
Compared to other parts.
100% agreed. I grew up in the Southeast, and my dad had a shotgun under the bed the whole time I grew up. And,
sure.
And I do not, I mean, I respect the Second Amendment and the right to bear arms. Having said that, clearly there is a problem when you have kids, teenagers walking around carrying, especially the kinds of statistics we heard from that youth panel, which 50, 60, 70% of teenagers walking around in these neighborhoods carrying firearms. And so I do think we have to figure out ways to do more and do better on that front, but I also don't think it's a panacea. This is not AK-47s that are killing kids in these neighborhoods for the most part. They're just handguns for the most part. And I don't think that we're ever, it'd be like trying to get all the fish out of Lake Michigan to get all the handguns out of the city of Chicago. Even if you wanted to or it was legal, which it's not, you couldn't do it. And so that's why I chose in the letter to focus on what I think are really the underlying issues that cause kids to be in a position to be carrying that firearm in the first instance.
Well, I'm so glad that you, I mean, I appreciate and we appreciate all the work you do. Particularly appreciate both in your presentations and in the panels you organized in our conversation today, you helping us keep the focus, as you did in the letter, on widespread systemic issues and solutions. So if I may characterize the last thing you said, it's about the guns, but it's really about much, much more. It's about opportunity, economic opportunity, and social justice in those communities. So I sort of, and I hope this is true of our listeners, I circle back to that optimism because of the commitment state and local and federal authorities have to provide opportunity in those communities. And then you and I wouldn't say then the gun violence problem solves itself, but boy, we make some really substantial headway.
Yeah, amen. So, you know, back to the panel series and for, you know, anybody who wants to go look at those videos because, and you tick these off, but from the law enforcement leadership community, from the not-for-profit leadership community, from business and philanthropy community, and from the local government community, you heard some really smart people who are not dealing with these issues superficially. These are folks who are steeped in living and breathing these issues all the time. And this just convergence of ideas and consensus of views about the fact that this is a multifaceted problem that requires multifaceted solutions over a very long period of time. Folks get it. And again, I think the philanthropic support is there. And I think things are improving in a variety of ways, at least from my perspective, but we need more hands on deck. I mean, frankly, when you asked me last summer if I was interested in affiliating with a law school, I told you I'd be honored to do so. But I also told you that I wanted to do something that mattered. And my next thought was the Northwestern law students who are going to be graduating now are going to be out there practicing the way I was in 5 years and in 10 years. And they're going to have, whether they're in the private sector or the public sector, they're going to be making decisions about how are they investing their time, their intellect, their leadership. And there is no issue to me that can or will be more important than this issue over the long haul. I worry about ebbs and statistics causing people to get distracted by other issues, because there are lots of issues, you know, that we face in the city of Chicago and the state of Illinois. But this issue is, again, one about who we are as a society. And this paradigm that we've been living with for years is unacceptable, and we have to change it. So I'm hoping that more and more people will step up and embrace it and become part of this.
Well, I really appreciate that. You know, it's notable, too. We have many listeners of this podcast series who are throughout the United States. And we have many of our students at our law school at Northwestern who go off to practice throughout the United States and throughout the world. And so while we've spent appropriately time focusing on our beloved city, on Chicago, if all the stakeholders get together and really can develop constructive solutions to this problem, that can be a template for dealing with these issues in any large urban city.
Right.
Because the citizens of Philadelphia care about their beloved city. Citizens of Los Angeles care about their beloved city. And gun violence is not unique to Chicago.
Yeah. And apropos of that, I just want to make this clear. I'm not, and I don't think any of us are, Pollyannish. We don't pretend that we can just sort of wave some magic wand and the poverty and the challenges with infrastructure and the educational issues these kids face are going to be solved. But I do think that we have, in the city of Chicago, we have so much strength across the board in so many different ways. It is, to this day, my favorite city in the world. And again, I had never even set foot here until I was 30 years old in 1997 and moved up here. And so leveraging that strength to help us get past this paradigm and past this issue will make us better and stronger, not only here, but, you know, across the United States of America and across the world. Nothing can stop Chicago, in my view, but we need to get past this issue to really shine the way the city deserves to shine.
Well, as the saying goes, when the Lord closed a door, as it were, by your untimely removal as U.S. attorney, he opened a window, and the window is really just the incredible work that you've been doing here at the school and throughout the community. I want to say on behalf of all of us Chicagoans, really appreciate your help and your leadership on this issue.
It's my honor, and I appreciate the opportunity to continue this discussion in such a great forum. Great.
Thank you. Well, that's our show for today. I want to thank Zach Fardon for joining us this morning, and I want to say on behalf of Northwestern Pritzker School of Law, thank you for joining us.
If you'd like more information about today's show, please visit law.northwestern.edu/planetlex or legaltalknetwork.com. Subscribe via iTunes and RSS. Find both Northwestern Pritzker School of Law and Legal Talk Network on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn. Or download the free app from Legal Talk Network in Google Play and iTunes. The views expressed by the participants of this program are their own and do not represent the views of, nor are they endorsed by, Northwestern University, Legal Talk Network, or their respective officers, directors, employees, agents, representatives, shareholders, and subsidiaries. None of the content should be considered legal advice. As always, consult a lawyer.